Hey guys, my name is SickabyOT1, and I'm losing it, aren't I? I'm trying to be more positive, I really am, but things are just getting discouraging on the Hot 100 and...
Wait, what? Oh, please don't let it be Fangs Wolf, please don't let it be Fangs Wolf, please don't let it be Fangs Wolf!
Ahem.
Fang, how are you doing? I didn't know we were reviewing the same week. Oh, I must have missed that one. I mean, you said you were changing the schedule.
So I've settled that Top 20 Ranked needs to move to a different month. So July is going to be the last time you see me doing this by Ethan's schedule.
I'm not getting out of this, am I?
No. Summer Top 20 Ranked. Looking over the last two seasons, I can't describe how much excitement and dread doing this video gave me. I love doing Top 20 Ranked, and it allows me to sum up my thoughts about certain songs better than I would have otherwise been able to if I just made a plain review about them. But in the same swing, this year has just not been looking good.
Personally, I tried to give it the benefit of the doubt when I did my spring ranking, but since then, things have only gotten worse.
For example, we've had some ugly attitudes infesting the top 10 with casual misogyny and other embarrassments.
That's just on a lyrical level, though. Looking at the music we got, 2018 seems to be the worst of 2014 mixed with the worst of 2016. That's not a good combo.
Not to mention Trap's influence is still here and not dying fast enough. Thanks, Migos and Drake.
I don't think that'd be as much of a problem if the Trap that got popular weren't so empty and lifeless, but let's save that for when we need it. You guys should know the six-tier ranking system at this point, and if you watch my videos at all, you know I have my own ranking system to determine the quality of the charts overall. Since there are two of us, we are both ranking the songs individually, and then we're dividing our total score by 200. Also, we can't exactly put these songs into tiers, so we put them in order based on their rank and the tier they landed in. Amber and I gave them a set of points based on these two things, and then we just numbered them accordingly. Looks something like this.
Also, I heard you all loud and clear. I'm going back to starting at the bottom tier. Thanks for the input, by the way.
Also, we're not talking about Nonstop, because it's a non-single that shouldn't still be in the top 20. In its place, we're going to be talking about the song at 21, Don't Matter to Me, No. The song at 22, Perf, I mean, In My Blood at 23. That'll work, right?
That's one of the bunch, so yeah.
Great! So without further ado, let's dive into the top 20, starting with... this guy. Again. I want to make one thing clear. I don't have to like X's music just because he died.
I wouldn't wish what happened to him on anyone, but that doesn't change the fact that this is still a despicable song through and through. It's gaslighting, it's incredibly offensive to the subject of suicide and mental health, and the fact that it posthumously hit number one infuriates me.
What else can I say, but this is sad.
If by sad you mean pathetic, then yes, yes you were. Look, I have a rule about speaking ill of the dead, but when a song is this toxic and makes 1-800 seem like a godsend in comparison, it's thrown out the window. This song is sickening through and through, and it pisses me off for existing.
So would you say that... I'm upset. 50,000 on my head. Well, how do you think we feel? Your wolves aren't going to eat me, are they?
They're not chasing you, are they?
I'll try to keep this one brief. Can't go 50-50
with no hope. Any goodwill Drake got from Nice For What was pretty much dashed when he released this. A ripoff of 21 Savage's bank account that further delves into Drake's insecurities and bitchiness that makes me wonder why I ever root for this guy.
Plus he had to make a video with his old Degrassi alumni to get people to care about this song. That's how bad it is. Fang? Are you okay?
No, I want to tear this to shreds. Professional music critics thrash the fucking album, and yet this is in the top 20. What the fuck? She
can get a taste. And I think I'd use that same phrase to describe my reaction to Tyga's comeback.
You remember this guy, right? Buddy buddy with Chris Brown, always sounded unenthusiastic about everything, made a song in 2015 where he admitted to screwing a 16-year-old Kylie Jenner.
And now, in 2018, he's on track to getting his biggest hit as a lead artist. I feel dirty for multiple reasons.
Yeah, can we not have another pedophile in the top 20, please? We just got rid of the last one.
Whole lot of styles, can't even pronounce the name.
Everyone knows by now that Tyga's never sounded enthused about rapping. His tone is constantly the same, and he doesn't try to change it up here. The song is the same brag rap he's known for, only instead of a boring beat, he's got a creepy one. Having creepy music is fine, but your tone and your content need to match it. And, as established by Ray Shremmerd last year, the combination of bragging with this level of tension and discomfort flat out doesn't work.
If you ask me, the biggest offense is that he's trying to use this beat for what's supposed to be a summer song.
With the strange warped vocal sample, this is striking me as a bit of a mix between Offset's Ric Flair drip and Black Youngsta's booty. And it sounds like trash. As Fang established, it's incredibly creepy, which is the last tone you want to set for both a summer song and a song for an artist with a controversial personal life.
But what I think what disturbs me the most is this line here. And she gonna suck me
like a fucking high C. Yeah, comparing a blowjob to drinking a juice box is more than a little disturbing if you ask me.
Oh, no question. That's if you're not laughing at how ridiculous the line is. I mean, to me, it just sounds like his dick is as thin as one of those straws that comes with a juice box.
That's gonna be some kind of record.
I'm convinced Offset is the only reason anyone cares about this song. I guess his verse is a little better than Tyga's, but I just don't care.
Also worth noting that Iggy Azalea just got her first Hot 100 entry in 2 years with a Tyga feature. So Migos are indirectly responsible for the return of Iggy Azalea.
Oh no, don't jinx it, she's still in the mid-90s.
And hopefully it'll stay that way.
Or just disappear like Pretty Girls and Team did. That'd be great!
I have never felt more stupid for believing in a new artist than this moment here.
Who, Marshmallow for thinking he had any form of integrity, or Anne-Marie for thinking she had any form of talent?
I don't even know. You say you love me,
I say you crazy. Usually when a song deals with the oh-so-controversial topic of the friend zone, the singer tends to bitch about how they've been friend-zoned. The friend zone is bad, people. That's what everyone wants you to know.
But Anne-Marie wears the title of friend zone like a badge of honor. Truly a groundbreaker.
If this song were about how she just hurt this guy's feelings, I think it would have worked a lot better. But the guy in question walks into stalker territory, so you can't really blame Anne for pushing him away. But that then begs the question, why she hasn't called the cops on his ass yet. And he's not gonna leave you alone. He actually can't be reasoned with. Cut the cord and get out of there already! Even then, the pretentious tone in the singing doesn't help either. Not to mention the fact that this song is a straight ripoff of Rockabye. Thanks, Ducky. I didn't know what brought me back to this thing until you brought that up. Also, gang vocals. Still feels like 2014.
Yeah, this song is just badly produced. It's too loud, the gang vocals are stupid and unnecessary. Anne-Marie sounds like she's got something stuck in her throat as she misspells the word friends without the E. It really wouldn't have been that hard to fit it in the meter either.
In fact, let me show you. Want me to spell it out for you? F-R-I-E-N-D-S. Also censor beeps because comedy?
I think the worst part about the production is the synths. Like, why these tones? It's ugly, it's got too much bass, it clashes terribly with the trap percussion, and it doesn't sound like it was mixed properly. Back when the song first released, I wasn't sure if I'd give the song a pass or not, or if I could ever hate it. I hate it now. Next! I've only heard this song in bits, and I'm happy keeping it that way.
To be fair, it's basically a fragment of a song anyway.
I really hate that Drake has the power to take a nobody and make them into a superstar, especially when they're clearly not talented. Lil Baby is basically just a Young Thug clone with less personality and talent, which makes sense considering Thugger is his mentor.
I just recently learned to like Young Thug, and now the universe wants me to do it all over again. Do you understand just how long that took the last time?
No, and honestly, I don't really notice. But bits of the song I've heard just sound like Gucci Gang all over again. Yes, indeed, it's a lot more bass heavy, but it can't hide what it is. You think it's hard to replace a chorus saying Gucci Gang over and over again with actual lyrics? We are talking about a song that peaked at number 3 just this year, and it's more enticing to listen to than its downbeat clone. That's pathetic.
Give Lil Pump this, at least he had more going on.
Yes, indeed, feels unfinished. There's nothing going on in this beach that I can see liking or wanting to come back to. Plus, it feels like a bait and switch. Hey, it's Drake. You like Drake, right? And then a third of the way through the song, you get this nobody. It worked in my favor because nobody's brand new
whip got no keys. I'd call this a Rick Roll if Drake's part was remotely good, or if I wasn't sick of the other 23 songs he has currently clogging up the charts.
Yeah, the only reason this song is as high on my ranking is because I've yet to hear the nobody on the song. And again, I'm happy keeping it that way. Screw this! Kiki, do you
love me? Are you riding? Drake. Again.
Remember how we said we're skipping Nonstop? Well, we would have skipped this song too if it hadn't become a single and gone to number 1.
Because for the life of me, I cannot get myself to remember how this song goes.
Scorpion was a terrible album, and yet it broke numerous records, even those previously set by Drake. At this point, he's past the point of overexposure and just taken the role of a pest. I just don't get it.
I think I do. Or at least I know why he's back.
America, I beg you, please, 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 make him go away next year, please.
Yeah, this one's on me. I'm so sorry, guys.
Actually, I think this is my doing.
2017 will be known as the year Drake died. Yes, his overexposure and half-assed musical ideas finally caught up with him.
Oh. Okay. Do we have to talk about the cluttered production on this song, or can we move on?
I think I'll just let a bit of the breakdown towards the end speak for itself, and then we'll call it a day.
You know, I've heard a lot of people compare this guy to Post Malone, and yeah, I see it.
But personally, he reminds me more of Lil Skies. And I got all the drugs
in the world that you need. This guy had some minor success on the charts earlier this year, and for the most part was in my good graces. I even listened to the album he put out this year, and it was alright. And the reason I kinda liked him is because he sounded like he was having some fun and had a bit of personality.
Juice WRLD is what Lil Skies would sound like if you took away that personality. And yet at this point, he is by far the more famous of the two.
Yeah, and for a diet rehash song of a guy getting dumped for the first time, with the beat stolen from Shape of My Heart by Sting. Now, why would I listen to Lucid Dreams when there's this, honestly?
Oh, but Kumarai Fang, he's just so charming, especially when he says, "Who knew evil girls had the prettiest face?"
Piss off!
Not to mention, he has another song charting right now called All Girls Are the Same. We let this guy have a top 5 hit. What is wrong with us?
Let's just pray the change to streaming rules cuts him off.
Stolen beats, casual misogyny, and a flat roller coaster of a performance only really propped up by autotune, and you've got something that needs to go away as soon as possible. Please, no more SoundCloud rap.
Oh my god, it's still here. Why?
Probably for the same reason Body Like a Backroad stuck around last year.
You mean pop radio airplay?
No, magic pixie dust.
Ugh, I hate everything.
Well, save it. There's still more shit to dish out. Baby, lay on back and relax. I think this is one of the few times I've been split on what broke this song down. Florida Georgia Line's meatheadedness in the lyrics or Baby Rex's singing. I mean, one makes up for it for decent singing. It is meant to be. While the other has more lyrical context going for it. But my heart's been hurt a couple times
by a couple guys that didn't treat me right. How about both on the hook? If it's meant to be,
it'll be. Ugh.
Thought so. Got anything else to add? Cause I don't.
I'll pass, thanks. There was a brief period where I thought that Cardi B could improve anyone's song. I forgot Maroon 5 existed during that time frame. They take away anything interesting from their collaborators and turn it to sludge.
Well, to be fair, she came out looking better than Kendrick or SZA, you gotta give her that.
Eh, the song really doesn't help her, even if she were trying. Not too long ago, I was dancing for dollars. No, it's really rude if I let you be my mama. Like, there is nothing happening in this song. Everything remains on a flat line from beginning to end.
Personally, I think I'm a little more forgiving of this song. But only barely.
The first time I heard this, I thought the acoustic guitars were an okay touch and that Cardi's verse was passable. Though with repeated listens, it does kind of wear thin. It's just, hey, I'm Adam Levine and I like girls and I can get Cardi B in my song because I'm a superstar.
At least it's not weight in the top five, though.
Maroon 5 on autopilot versus Maroon 5 on autopilot with Cardi B. Somehow that's not much of an improvement.
At this point, I alternate between finding this annoying as shit and tolerable at the very least. Don't really have much more to add at this point.
I do! Zed stole the beat from a different producer! The original song is called Skin Contest. It's by producer Absurdus featuring Just JR. It was released in 2014. Zed straight up took the beat and notched it up 4 semitones. Hell, Absurdus showed this off in a Twitter post just to show how identical the songs were.
Hooray! Zed's a hack then. Guess that's one thing Todd forgot to mention when he reviewed this song. God's plan.
God's plan. You can keep your gods, hon. I'm fine with the gods over here.
It's a shrinker.
At first I thought this song was forgettable, then there was a time where I kinda got into it, but now it doesn't really click with me that much anymore. The magic's gone.
I gotta say Scorpion had anything to do with that, except I totally am.
Drake, go away! I've made it my job not to listen to this song ever since it hit the top 5. I don't regret that. My opinion of it hasn't improved, and it's almost as forgettable as White Iverson was.
I mean, I like it. Not as much as I used to, but I still like it.
Like with God's Plan, this clicked with me pretty well at one point, but that's lost now. I think the beat and post's flow got a little too banal.
Still like it, but it's not getting anywhere near my best list.
Eh, I'll take an actual Psycho song, thanks. This is okay. I feel like I felt this way about most every Ariana Grande song I've ever listened to. Dangerous Woman, Into You, Problem, One Last Time, Break Free. Ariana's just been on a consistent level of okay with me. Save for a few exceptions, I don't find her as groundbreaking as people claim her to be. If anything, I think she's a tad overrated. And it's not for anything on her end. The woman's got pipes, and I think she manages the song well. However, I feel like the song gets a bit awkward at points, especially in the verses. And the bombastic chorus, quote-unquote, doesn't really feel like the explosive payoff that it's trying to be. Props for getting an actual pop song back in the Hot 100, but I don't seek this out. And personally, I don't think it's anything special.
Yeah, I kind of agree, actually.
I've seen plenty of people go crazy for this song, and if you love it, that's fine. But I kind of feel underwhelmed.
I mean, take the very beginning of the song.
The intro is very delicate and awe-inspiring, especially on a first listen. But when it switches to the verses, you get this weird trap bounce thing that's hard to describe, and I don't think it really matches that well with the first chorus or even the other choruses.
I probably would have been more interested in this song if it was more like the intro. Maybe. But as it stands, I think that Dangerous Woman is the better lead-off single. Sorry.
I don't, but it does look like it's gonna be the better album. Oh, this does not give me a good feeling.
This song has only grown in my opinion since I last talked about it, mostly because I listened to Bozzy's album since my last ranking.
And it was fine. amazing, but fine. I'm not sure why everyone was so negative about it.
I don't know. I mean, at its worst, it's just a song that you can nod off to. At least, that's what I want to do when it comes on.
I mean, it's meant to be relaxing. I'll give you that.
Yeah, it's also supposed to be a guy trying to swoon me. Not gonna happen if I fall asleep.
Yeah, I'm not gonna win this one. Let's just move on. Oh hey, another pop song! What a novelty.
It's not something I revisit that often, but it's still refreshing. I especially like the rhythm of the percussion in particular, especially that little blocky plink at the end of every phrase. The synths are also fine and romantic. It's definitely got a nice atmosphere I've been missing in pop music this year.
And LMA herself sounds fine, a bit similar to Rihanna to be all that distinct, especially with those nonsense syllables, but she's still pretty charming.
R&B is not my shtick, but I do think this is a nice tune. LMA is a good singer, and I think it's nice that DJ Mustard went outside the box for once. Wait, DJ Mustard? This is 2014 again!
Fang, just because we have a DJ Mustard song in the top 10 doesn't mean it's 2014 again. I woke up Chris Breezy. Never mind. You know I say that I am better now, better now. I only say that. I'm still a little confused that this was the big winner from the Beer Bonds and Bentley's album bomb. I mean, Over Now, Stay, and Ball for Me were right there.
It could have been worse. I actually think this is pretty good.
I mean, yeah, it is. It's fine.
There is a charm to the hazy production, and post-swallowing here is a lot more tolerable than on a lot of stuff on Stony, I'll give it that. Plus, the guitar lead in the chorus is ridiculously catchy, even if the subject matter is a bit more bitter than I'd otherwise like.
He's talking about how his ex and him say that they're better off now that they're separate. It's hard not to include some toxic feelings in there.
Something that would be intolerable if it weren't intentional. It's part of what makes the song both likable and relatable.
Maybe this will grow on me later. For now, I'm kind of lukewarm on it because it's been easy to avoid and I haven't really revisited that often since Beer Bonds and Bentley's came out. Still good, just need to sit on it for a while, I guess.
I, for one, have never listened to Beer Bonds and Bentley's. Probably should, it might help me with the worst of 2018's released songs, but I don't really have much of a care for Post Malone outside of a couple songs, and thankfully, this is one of them. You know I said it, I am better now, I only say that 'cause you're not around, not around. To me, the shift in the chorus from the girl to Malone himself is saying, you're not over me, and by that I mean I miss you very much. The details in the verses sounds like this girl is trying to forget Malone and that he's struggling to come to grips with it. I was so broken over you. Yeah, it could have been better, but it's one of the more enjoyable, dreary songs we got in the top 20, so I'll take it. Oh hey, a song that tackles anxiety. I'm done with this.
Kind of a useful song this year, if you think about it.
Considering the fail that was 1-800, yeah, I'd say so. Is there somebody who could help me? I'd be lying if I said I thought In My Blood's lyrics were groundbreaking, but with what experience I have with anxiety and depression, this speaks more to me, and it's much more thought through in my opinion. I like how Sean doesn't try to come up with an answer to his problems, but rather tries to explain them. I can picture him in this position, not really able to help himself, but not really able to give up either.
When you look at it that way, it does hit a lot harder than I initially thought it did.
When I first heard this, it felt like kind of a letdown after There's Nothing Holding Me Back. I didn't hate it, but I didn't think this slower, more emotional song with thudding drums and Sean's yelping was doing much for me. Then I came to a realization after seeing a friend tweet something.
This is a song about insecurities and anxiety, co-written by Teddy Geiger, a transgender woman. This song was made for me.
I guess that's a random observation and might not actually mean that much, but it did lead me to feeling this song more than I had before. Sean's struggles ring as heartbreaking, and the thunderous booming of the chorus is incredibly cathartic because of it.
I agree entirely. However, I need to be in a certain mood to seek this out, and I think the production could have been a lot better than what it was. Still a good song, though.
Definitely a solid redemption after Illuminate, that's for sure. Is it cool that I said all that?
Is it too soon to do this yet? Not gonna lie, since Look What You Made Me Do, I've been avoiding most everything relating to Reputation. I didn't want to talk about Ready For It, but when Endgame was released as a single, I was kind of impressed. I didn't think that anyone could get Future to stay on topic, or given much effort for that matter. And the rest of the song was enjoyable. Now, I don't know if I like Delicate more than Endgame, but I'm glad it's seeing success. It's a simple love song where Taylor admits her insecurities, and that's a level of maturity most people on the charts now lack.
And you all dismissed Taylor for being cutesy.
Oh, I didn't dismiss her for being cutesy. I dismissed her for being the worst of emo trash in a quote-unquote pop song. Disgraceful.
Yeah, Delicate is definitely a step in the right direction after that song burned most of her goodwill from the public.
And the funny thing is, despite not peaking quite as high as Look What You Made Me Do, it's had much more longevity. It had to fight to get to the top 20, and it deserves it. The dreamy vocoders, the wonderful mixing, and Taylor's delicate, no pun intended, performance make this one of the best tracks on Reputation, and it was clearly a good pick for a Damage Control single.
See, Taylor? When you make good music, you're rewarded. When you make bad music, not so much.
Yeah, this is pretty good for being Damage Control. I don't know if it'll save her pop career or not, but if it does, I hope she's learned her lesson.
Cardi is our queen.
It took me a while to warm up to Cardi B, but I'm glad I did. And I say that as someone who thought her debut album was just okay. But I gotta hand it to America for once. They knew which song deserved to be the breakout hit from this album.
Oh yeah, this was an obvious pick for a single. And the fact that it features two stars from Latin America only makes sense. But, you know what? I'm happy with that. The sample is used wonderfully, and yes, Cardi is amazing, but Bad Bunny isn't half bad either. In fact, this is my greatest impression of him as a performer. I've heard some people talk about this song and say that Bad Bunny isn't even trying, and well, first of all, have you heard Table Tay? Excuse me, that's not trying. This is gold.
Just be glad you don't speak Spanish or else you'd hate this even more.
I watched Rodrigo's review of it. You kinda can't protect me with the language barrier.
We are not clean.
Personally, I think both Bad Bunny and J Balvin's parts outshine Cardi. I think they have personalities that more closely match the beach than Cardi herself does.
Even though J Balvin has this weird slip into English with a Lady Gaga reference out of nowhere.
Yeah, that and him referencing Mi Gente put him behind Cardi for me. I'll give you Bad Bunny, though.
Another year, another non-awful Latin song in the running for the title of Song of the Summer. No complaints there.
My favorite song of the week came from one of the worst albums that I've heard this year. I would say that's kind of sad, but I still think this is genuinely a great song.
I like this Drake. The one who's got energy and is working with a beat that sounded like it took more than 5 minutes to make. Plus one who's being more empowering for women, even if it's kind of at a surface level.
I don't think he's sounded this alive and excited since Back to Back from 2015. Wow, that was 3 years ago. Oh my god.
Well, what do you expect when Drake gets a good beat behind him? Something I notice about Drake is that when the beat tries, so does he. And depending on how much the beat tries will determine how much effort he puts in. All my niggas wanna do is pop style. Turn my birthday into a lifestyle. It's no surprise that Drake didn't want to put in much effort for songs that didn't have much to offer. If there's no fire in the music, why should he have any? I know I wouldn't be enthused to record over the schlock from Views, More Life, or Scorpion. And as bad as Scorpion is, I'll take this as a silver lining. At least when I talk about Drake on my worst list, I get to talk about him on my best list too.
Seriously, with a second single this strong, it's kind of stunning that Drake just didn't give a shit on the rest of Scorpion.
My favorite part of this song, oddly enough, is that weird breakdown with the chopped up vocals. What makes this work here and fail in In My Feelings is context. In My Feelings was about concern trolling and the freakout came out of nowhere. Here, I can just imagine Drake bouncing around and having a good time trying to spread some positivity to those who need it. Plus it feels more coherently mixed, if that's even possible.
Drake got me to headbang in 2018 and that's gotta count for something.
He made the best dance hit of 2018, Amber. It does. I can dance to this any day of the week, and I absolutely adore that. It's got a pulse, unlike the rest of the shit.
My score for this week was 42 points out of a possible 100. To put things in perspective, throughout 2016, I regularly kept track of my scores for the top 20, and I can't remember the score ever going below 50.
2018, so far, is worse than 2016. Think about that.
Oh yeah, I agree with that one. With our combined scores, Amber and I got 82 out of 100, which equals 41 out of 100, which is just on the cusp of below average. 1 point less, and this top 20 would have been wretched. And considering that my original score was 39 out of 100, I feel justified with what I said earlier. This year is not looking good, and if this is the best that summer has to offer us, I am really worried about what fall is gonna look like.
I'm sick of EOT1, sorry if this got more heated than usual. And take care. Oh, wait. Also, subscribe to Kung Rai Fang, because she very much deserves your attention.
Aw, thank you. Just for that, I'll make sure my wolves don't go fishing later.
Thank God.
You're welcome. I'm signing off, by the way. Bye, Amber. Bye, guys.